There is an experience that every single Nigerian can relate to. Electricity generation in Nigeria began in Lagos in 1886 with the use of generators to provide 60 kilowatts. In 1923, tin miners installed a 2-megawatt plant on the Kwali River. 6 years later, the Nigerian Electricity Supply Company, a private firm, was established near Jos to manage a hydroelectric plant at Kura to power the mining industry. Then, another private enterprise was established in Sapele by United Africa Company to power the activities of African Timber and Plywood Company. Between 1886 and 1945, electric power generation was rather low, with power provided largely to Lagos and other commercial centers such as mining industries in Jos and Enugu. The colonial government created an electricity department within the Public Works Department, which then installed generating sets in many cities to serve government reservation areas and commercial centers. In 1950, the Legislative Council of Nigeria began moves to integrate the electricity industry when it enacted a law to establish the Electricity Corporation of Nigeria, with the duties of developing and supplying electricity. ECN took over the electricity sector activities within the PWD and the generating sets of native authorities. In 1951, the firm managed 46 megawatts of electricity. Between 1952 and 1960, the firm established coal-powered turbines at Oji and Ijara, Lagos, and began making preliminary plans for a transmission network to link the power-generating sites with other commercial centers. In 1961, ECN completed a 132 kV transmission line linking Lagos to Ibadan via Sagamu. In 1965, this line was extended to Oshogbo, Benin, Ogeli to form the Western System. 1962, a statutory organization, the Niger Dams Authority, was formed to build and maintain dams along River Niger and Kaduna River. NDA went on to commission a 320 megawatt hydropower plant at Kainji in 1969, with the power generated sold to ECN. In 1972, NDA and ECN merged to form the National Electric Power Authority, NEPA. NEPA was the major electricity firm in Nigeria until power sector reforms, which began in 2005, resulted in the creation of the Power Holding Company of Nigeria and later privatization of electricity generation and distribution. 2014, the sector was privatized with three groups having the responsibility of providing power. Energy is a key source of economic growth because many production and consumption activities involve energy as a basic input. Energy is one of the most important inputs for economic development. From a physical viewpoint, the use of energy drives economic productivity and industrial growth and is central to the operation of any modern economy. Energy is responsible for at least half the industrial growth in a modern economy, while representing less than one-tenth of the cost of production. Some analysts argue that growth in energy use directly causes growth in GDP. For this reason, the Tertiary Education Trust Fund has locked in on energy as one of the thematic groups of its Research and Development Standing Committee's work, in addition to being a critical subject for TET Fund Centers of Excellence. The Executive Secretary of TET Fund, Professor Suleiman Elias Bogoru, explains why energy is essential to the paradigm shift.
I mean, is there anything that we don't require consistent power? I mean, that is very obvious. And for power, from electric to all renewable power sources, solar in particular, as it were, in the northern part of the country where there is more of, consistent sunshine. We want to harvest it for maximum utilization for purposes of generating power for the beneficiary institutions. You want to be sure that your ICT unit, you have the power is there, the laboratories. There are some experimentation that if light goes off for 48 hours, the whole experiment has been messed up. You better imagine that. And then, like I said about vaccine, the storage of vaccine requires, you know it, prescribed temperatures. And in most cases, below zero, far below zero. And especially for Pfizer vaccine, you're talking about minus 70, as it were. And it's for other vaccines that may not be as low as that. But look at it, if you don't have regular power supply, that is a problem. But more importantly, like I said, looking at the options of renewable energy and consistent with environmental prescription, climate change requirements and all.
Professor Abubakar Sambo is the chairman of the Energy Thematic Group of the TET Fund Research and Development Standing Committee. He gives an overview on the state of Nigeria's power sector.
You know, the power sector in Nigeria is very epileptic at the moment. Number one, you have a population of more than 200 million, and the power sector that is available for this huge number of Nigerians is at best about 5,000 megawatts. And this leads to massive load shedding all over the Federation. And so many Nigerians, overwhelming majority for that matter, are not happy with the power situation of the country. So TET Fund set out through our thematic group to see that in the years to come, a lot of projects and programs that touch on research and development will come up with outputs that at the end of the day will help improve the situation of power sector significantly.
The electricity sector in Nigeria generates, transmits, and distributes megawatts of electric power that is significantly less than what is needed to meet basic household and industrial needs. 2012, the industry labored to distribute 5,000 megawatts, very much less than the 40,000 megawatts needed to sustain the basic needs of the population. This deficit is also exacerbated by unannounced load shedding, partial and total system collapse, and power failure. To meet this demand, many households and businesses resort to purchasing generating sets to power their properties. This source of energy provided 6,000 megawatts in 2008.
There are several levels of comparison. If you take the average sub-Saharan Africa, when I say sub-Saharan Africa, I remove North African countries. North African countries at the moment, they have near 100% electricity access. But if you remove them, then the sub-Saharan Africa, they have electricity, average electricity consumption of about 500 kilowatt hour for each sub-Saharan African. Whereas that 5,000 megawatts considered over 1 year by 200 million Nigerians, it works out to a little more than 200 kilowatt hour for each Nigerian. So you can see we are just about 40% of the African average. Indeed, if you take the sub-Saharan African average of 500 kilowatt hour, for Nigerian situation, we will need about 11,500 megawatts. If we are to be at the level of sub-Saharan Africa at the moment, not 5,000 megawatts, we should be having about 11,500 megawatts. Now, to push you further, to tell you further, if you take the world average, and these are figures that are computed and publicized by International Energy Agency, which is a powerful body that does a lot of energy analysis. IEA says that the world average electricity consumption per capita is 2,600. If you apply that to the Nigerian situation right now, 200 million Nigerian world average, it will culminate into a figure of about 59,000 megawatts.
Africa today is the continent with the worst energy poverty, with about 600 million Africans living without access to electricity. IEA in 2009 puts the Nigerian energy access rate at 62%. The top 12 African nations that have much better electricity access rates are Mauritius with 100% access, Tunisia with 100% access, Egypt with 99.8%, Algeria with 99.1%, Morocco with 99%, the Seychelles 99%, Cape Verde 61%, South Africa with 94%, and Gabon with 92%. Others are Eswatini with 90%, Ghana 85%, and Kenya with 85%. To catch up with these neighbors who have left Nigeria behind, we will need to fund and strengthen our energy R&D institutions.
What is happening is that there are R&D energy institutions at the moment, many of them. There's the Energy Commission of Nigeria, there's the Nigeria Atomic Energy Commission, there's the National Agency for Science and Engineering Infrastructure, and so on and so forth. But what is happening is that the outputs, they are doing good works. The outputs are not taken up for mainstreaming into the economy. So that's why it looks as if they are not effective. They are doing good works. But that triple helix aspect from the research institution into industry, the missing link is missing, which is why we think tech funds intervention is going to work, because there will be deliberate effort to get the products of these research institutions to be absorbed into the economy through industrial production. So that is the missing link that is not there. But aside from that, there are quite a number of activities that need to be undertaken. And what the thematic group I'm heading has done is to group the R&D activities into three. The immediate ones that we think should be conducted as soon as the Research and Development Foundation is set up, to a maximum of 1 year. Then the medium-term ones, the ones that should be undertaken between 1 and 3 years, and the long-term ones that should be taken between 3 to 5 years. There are quite a number of activities that need to be done, which we think, the first one, there are some powerful planning documents that some of these research institutions that I mentioned were supposed to do, but for years they have not been able to do. So we think within a matter of months, with the seriousness of the TED Fund idea, we are going to have stakeholders, not necessarily Energy Thematic Group. We invite others from the institutions that I mentioned to come, we sit with them, we develop those documents. Then there are other strategies that could be taken up immediately, like issue of combined cycle gas turbines. What is it that is bedeviling them? Then the issue of off-grid mini-grids that could be done right away. In fact, there are some technologies like nuclear modular reactors. There are small nuclear reactors that could be deployed quickly to start producing electricity. So what we do research-wise is like industry research. We brainstorm, we ask, we check, and we find the best way to do. Look at what other countries have done, how they've made it. So these are the quick wins. We think they are the low-hanging fruit. Then the ones that require more detailed study, in fact, we may even use laboratories to check, those are the ones that we'll do between 1 and 3 years. And the ones at the very end will be the ones that are very long term, like the studies to ensure nuclear power comes on stream. You know, nuclear power is a bit of a long thing. Then we need to check everything that we have done in the first term, that is the short term, the medium term, through the standard technique of assessing strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. That's what analysis, and what we see, we now plow back into the R&D activities.
For Nigeria to meet its lofty targets, a power generation mix is required. The Energy Thematic Group visited existing power generating plants across Nigeria. Visits were made to some organizations in the Nigerian energy value chain to, among other things, understand their operating environment, to identify their strengths, constraints, and opportunities, to appraise their conformity or otherwise with the triple helix model of industry, government, academia partnership, to identify the bottlenecks and critical paths in achieving the triple helix model, and finally, to identify their research needs that could be attended to by research institutes.
We visited the hydropower plants. All the big ones, the major hydropower plants at Niger State, Kayinji, Jeba, and Shororo. We visited the largest thermal power station in the country at Egbin, whose nameplate capacity is more than 1,000 megawatts. Then, like you correctly mentioned, we visited the solar. There's a solar plant here in Buari at the Usuma Dam. Then there are other several solar plants in the country, in Katsina, in Kano, we all visited them. There's a wind turbine that has been pipelined for quite a while, 10 megawatts wind plant in Katsina State. We also visited. Then we visited two research centers out of the existing ones. There are several. We visited the Center for Energy Efficiency and Conservation at the University of Lagos. We also visited the Center for Energy Research and Training at Amadu Bello University, Zaria. That Lagos is handling all energy types, but targeted to energy efficiency and conservation, while that in Zaria is nuclear energy based. In fact, the one in Zaria, they have a miniature research reactor with which Nigerians can learn the details, the workings of a nuclear power plant. That is, then the center in Lagos is strategic because in energy supply and consumption, entrenchment of energy efficiency and conservation concepts could lead to a reduction of up to 40%. So it's like 40% of electricity generation not done or saved. Or in other words, you save 40% to energize other places that are not yet energized. So that's why they are very important. So the visit we did were very good. They reminded us of what we knew and even showed us a few things that we were not aware. And I think it's very healthy, so that by the time we get cracking in terms of research and development, we'll have some of these things that we have seen fresh in our mind.
What is the way forward for electricity supply in Nigeria? The Energy Thematic Group recommends the following: increased electricity generation through expansion of the energy mix. The energy mix for electricity generation should be expanded from the current two sources of gas and hydro to seven of gas, hydro, clean coal, nuclear, solar, wind, and biomass. This is necessary for the significant increase in electricity supply from the current 4,500 megawatts to about 63,000 megawatts by the year 2030. And that will enable Nigeria meet goal 7 of the UN's SDGs. Special purpose vehicle for expansion of the energy mix for electricity generation. The NIPP/NDPHC model should be appropriately amended to bring on board the expanded energy mix of renewable and clean coal plants, as well as modular nuclear reactors. This should include the power plants and the associated infrastructure for evacuating the power. The plants, after completion, should be sold or concessioned to the private sector after transparent bidding processes. The expansion of the energy mix. Now, the mix should be undertaken in an organized fashion based on the determination of the nation's electricity demand and supply projections, deploying computer-based models as done by the Energy Commission of Nigeria using the 2050 Pathway Calculator tool, initially developed by the DECC of the UK, but adapted to our local conditions. Other recommendations include integrating Vision 30-30-30 for power with goal number 7 of the SDGs and also with the recent Siemens roadmap for power. To use embedded power plants to bridge the demand and supply gaps in municipalities that are major load centers. To use off-grid and mini-grid plants for locations far away from transmission networks. To use small modular reactors as mini-grids and embedded power plants to provide electricity with no carbon dioxide emissions. The provision of gas and other fuels. The numerous gas fields of the nation should be developed to ensure that the nation's gas power plants, which are the majority of the existing power plants, get the quality and quantity of gas they need. Also, arrangements with the relevant MDAs and indeed the private sector should be made for the provision of coal, uranium, and biofuels for future power plants, so that when the plants are ready, there will be no delays due to a lack of needful fuels. Government should also hold investment summits to get the private sector to better understand Nigerian terrain and to get a clearer picture of the economic potentials of the Nigerian electricity market. There should be an entrenchment of energy efficiency and conservation. Local production of spare parts and power plant components are very critical. And prompt arraignment for energy thefts. Anyone caught dealing electricity supply components or doing illegal connections or bypassing meters should be promptly dealt with in line with extant provisions. The establishment of a National Research and Development Foundation to be funded by the federal government and TED Fund and having its instrument passed into law will significantly address the much-needed research and development gaps in all sectors of national development. The NRDF should have a unit on energy that will be responsible for addressing energy R&D, as well as the implementation of the triple helix model deploying the recommendations of this presentation. This will lead to adequate and reliable energy supply in a sustainable manner with potentials for increasing the national revenue base and leading to job creation. There is a need for the organized private sector, development partners, and entrepreneurs to be encouraged to support research and development projects and programs of the foundation. And that is the paradigm shift.